God told Abraham to go to Canaan land and start a brand new life and be a brand new man. He took his wife and nephew and did as he was told. But it's hard starting over at 75 years old. But God said, Abraham, look, for as far as you see, all of that land is a gift from me. It's a lesson for the learning, for the likes of you and me. Just have a little faith and you'll see. Well, Abraham was closing in on 99, and Sarah, bless her heart, wasn't very far behind. When God stopped in to visit in the heat of the day, said pretty soon there'll be a baby coming your way. But Sarah laughed and said, no, I don't believe that it's true. Me with a child, with an old man like you. It's a lesson for the learning, for the likes of you and me. Just have a little faith and you'll see.
Abraham, it's time for the big sacrifice. Build yourself a fire and sharpen up your knife. Take your little boy Isaac and put him in the flame, and kill him and burn him in God's holy name. Then God said, Abraham, don't, it was only a test. You passed the flying colors ahead above the rest.
It's a lesson for the learning, for the likes of you and me. Just have a little faith and you'll see.
The father of the faithful, the leader of the clan, he started out as just a simple country man. But God loved Abraham and Abraham loved him. It's a story to remember when your faith is growing dim and you get tired and you say, oh, it was different back then. But remember that they were only just men.
It's a lesson for the learning, for the likes of you and me. Just have a little faith and you'll see. Just have a little faith and you'll see. Just have a little faith and you'll see.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to this worship service for the second Sunday in Lent. We're glad you chose to worship with St. James today. As we gather our hearts and minds in worship, I want to say a special word of thanks to those volunteers who gave of their time on Saturday to help with the COVID-19 testing. We were thankful to be able to use our parking lot once again to offer this resource to the community, and thankful for those volunteers who came to make that possible. Hopefully you heard that we are resuming inside in-person worship service on March 7th. We will offer two services in our sanctuary, one at 8:30 and one at 11. We still need to follow all of our safety protocols, so you will need to pre-register. Registration will be up tomorrow, Monday, on our website, and you can register for either the 8:30 or the 11 o'clock service. Both services will be in the sanctuary. They'll be 30 to 35 minutes apiece. With the warmer weather, and hopefully some dry weather, we are gonna start our parking lot picnics again this Wednesday. You're welcome to bring your food, find some space in the parking lot, and enjoy food with your family from 5:30 to 6:30. You'll be able to see some other church families here as well. We hope to continue that each Wednesday now that we're closer to springtime. In March, we are planning to put together some blessing bags for some of the staff at Wesley Woods. There's information in our newsletter and Saturday Spotlight about that. The staff at Wesley Woods has done a great job caring for the residents of their community throughout this crisis, and we wanted to do something to encourage them. So we're trying to put together just some little gift bags for them. The items are listed on our website, in our newsletter, and in the Saturday Spotlight as well. So if you can support that in any way, we would appreciate any donations you can give as we offer some encouragement and blessing to those who have blessed so many. As we continue to worship together today, let us go to God in prayer. God, today we remember your call to Abram and Sarah, how you called them to continue to journey with you throughout the years. Sometimes they didn't know the way forward. Sometimes they wondered how long. Yet you were always with them. May we be ever mindful of your presence, and especially in this time of worship, may we silence the other voices in our hearts and minds so we can hear the still small voice of your Spirit saying, I am with you, and I will not leave you or forsake you. And strengthened and renewed by this awareness of your presence, may we go forth to share your love with others. Amen. Thank you.
Affirmation of faith today is the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning. I hope that you're doing well today. Today is the second Sunday of Lent. How's it been going so far? Did you give anything up for Lent? Today I want to tell you a story. This story is about a young man. This young man loved basketball. He decided that he was going to try out for the varsity team at his high school. He and about 50 other players were trying out for only 15 spots on the team. This young man tried his hardest at tryouts, but he wasn't very tall and not quite good enough, so he didn't make the team. After the list of the 15 varsity players was posted and he saw his name wasn't on the list, he went home and he cried. He had wanted it so badly. He didn't cry for long though. He decided to get up and do his best, playing for the junior varsity team. And he was quite a star. He never gave up hope that he'd be a great basketball player. And did he ever accomplish that? This young man, who didn't make the team when he was 15 years old, went on to become the greatest basketball player of all time. His name? Michael Jordan. But he soon went on to be called other nicknames like His Airness, Air Jordan, and lately, The GOAT. You know, that kind of reminds me of our scripture reading today. In today's lesson, we hear about two people named Abram and Sarai. Sarai longed to have a baby, and so did Abram. God promised them that they would. They were very old, though, and began to doubt that it would ever happen. God kept telling them that they'd have a baby and that their family would be more than all the stars in the sky. To make sure that they knew they'd have a baby, God changed their names to Abraham, which meant father of many nations, and Sarah, which meant princess of many. Finally, after many years of waiting, they had a baby and named him Isaac. And their families became greater than they ever could have imagined, just as God promised. I wonder if that's ever happened to you. I wonder if you've ever felt let down that things weren't going your way, but eventually you found that it all happened just as it should have. Or I wonder if that will happen to you. You see, God has a plan for each of us, and just because you may not be quite there yet, doesn't mean that God is finished with his plans for you. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your plans for us. Help us to remember to do our best, to be patient, faithful, and hard workers as we wait for your plans to come true. Amen.
Can it be? He left his father's throne above, so free, so infinite his grace, emptied himself of all but love, and left for Adam's helpless grace.
Today's scripture reading comes from Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 through 7, and verses 15 through 16. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, "I am God Almighty. Walk with me faithfully and be blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers." Abram fell face down, and God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham, for I have made you the father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you, for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants for you." God also said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you will no longer to call her Sarai. Her name will be Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give you a son by her. I will bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings of people will come from her." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Walk before me and be blameless. This is the third time God comes to Abram and says, "Walk before me." The first time, Abram is at home in his native country, and God says, "Walk before me, go to the land of promise." Abram leaves his country. He leaves most of his family. He travels with just his immediate relatives to this land of promise. At that first encounter, we are told that Abram is 75 years old. In this story, he is 99 years old. He has been walking for 24 years. He walked away from his native land, from his people. He walked to the land of promise. He walked the length and the breadth of that land. What he has not done is walked as a father. And that is key to the promise. God says, "I'm taking you to this land that I will promise to your descendants, who will be as numerous as the stars in the heaven and the sand on the seashore." But so far, there's not the first descendant. And Abram and Sarai have been walking for 24 years. They are at an age and a stage when walking usually becomes more difficult. They are at an age where people are more prone to look for gerontologists than pediatricians. Yet God comes for a third time and says to Abram, "Walk before me. Continue walking in the light of my promise. And be blameless." Be blameless. This is the second time in the Bible when that word is used, be blameless. The first time takes us back to a story we heard part of last week, the story of Noah. When Noah is introduced in Genesis chapter 6, we are told that Noah is a righteous man and blameless in his generation. He walked with God. Noah, of course, is the one through whom God will bring about the salvation of humans and all created life on the earth. The one that God calls to build the ark, and his family and the animals will be the means for new life after the flood. No small pressure there than when God comes to Abram and says, "Keep walking and be blameless." I don't think being blameless means to be without error, to be perfect in all of our ways. I think God is after something more there. I think God is trying to remind us that to be a people of faith means to walk in the light of God's promises, even when we don't know where the journey may take us. When we don't know all the deadlines, when we don't know where the child will be born or when the child will be born. Both times, with Noah and here with Abram, the be blameless is tied to walking before God. We know from the story of Abram, there were times when Abram doubted, questioned, wondered when God would fulfill the promise. There are even times when Abram and Sarah seem to put the promise in jeopardy by trying to help God along, create a child in another way. Yet, Abram, when he realizes he has gone in the wrong direction, when he has put the promise at risk or put his loved ones at risk, and he is made aware of that, continues to walk with God. He changes his direction. He continues to walk in the light of that promise. In the words of Jesus in the New Testament, he repents. That's what repentance means. It is that moment when we realize we have tried to go in our own direction and it has caused us to separate from the direction of God. Maybe because we weren't getting enough information from God about when the promise would be fulfilled or how the promise would be fulfilled. Yet when we realize we have done that, we are invited to live in the light of God's grace by repenting and setting our feet back in the pathways of God's promise. That's what it means to continue walking with God. To realize there may be times when we stumble over rocks in the path, or in the darkness we take a wrong turn. But that when God's grace shines the light on our errors, we can turn to God and continue our journey. No wonder when God comes this third time to remind Abram to continue walking, even in his advanced age, to continue with his wife Sarai. God gives them a new name. To be people who continue to walk in the light of God's grace, who continue to alter our course to be in line with God's purposes, not only sets our direction, it changes our identity. It makes us new beings. So Abram becomes Abraham. And Sarai becomes Sarah, because they have been changed by their willingness to continue journeying with God and living in the light of God's promise. In the days of the early church, when a Christian came to proclaim, "I want to be a disciple of Christ. I want to be one who follows the way of Jesus," when they went through the process of baptism, they were given a new name. Often they would take the name of one of the saints, John, Peter, James, Mary, Martha. And it was to remind them that they were to take on this identity of those first followers of Jesus, who, like Abram and Sarah, were often called to set aside the familiar and the known for the insecure and the unknown, and be willing to travel wherever Jesus might call us. That practice has carried over through the centuries in a unique way in the early English church. When a baby was brought to be baptized, they referred to their Christian name. That's when they were given their Christian name, and it came to be known as a christening. We don't so much assign new names to new disciples today when they come for baptism or to be received into membership of the church. It's usually reserved for those who enter a religious order, or when a pope is elected, they take on a new name. But those are merely reminders that to be a people of faith, to be those who are willing to say, "Yes, I will continue walking with God and be blameless," is to be a people who are willing to have our very identity changed, to be made over anew into the image of Christ, so that we can truly be God's loved sons and daughters. Continue to walk before God and be blameless. Thanks be to God. Amen.
To thee.
as you go forth to continue your journey with God in the world. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The countenance of the Lord rise upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.